Okay, for those of you that may not know me, I'm Bob Brokaw. What I'm going to do today is talk to you about shop-made vacuum systems.
Probably one of the first questions that pops to your head is why? And my answer to that is I kind of bumped up against all kinds of limitations in my shop when I decided to make some veneered objects. One of the first challenges that I was given was by my daughter. She wanted me to make a king-size headboard with four marquetry panels on the ends. And along the way toward achieving that goal, I found out it takes some clamps and more clamps and pretty near impossible things in the form of clamps. One of the false starts that I had on that was you take a substrate that you want to put a piece of veneer on. You apply the glue and so forth. You put some platens on there to flatten the thing, and then you start thinking about how am I going to clamp this thing, and the idea comes to mind, well, let's see, we could, you know, since I can't reach to the full inside of this thing with a clamp, let's put the car on top of it. So you drive the car up on top of there, and then you find out how oily that glue is. It just wants to slide all over the place. That didn't work so good, so then I started trying to figure out ways to clamp veneer in a reliable fashion, and somebody pointed me toward the websites of Gurleski, his name is. He's commonly known as Joe Woodworker. I will give him attribution on one of these pages here in a little bit, but for people who are interested in veneering and vacuum systems like what I'm going to talk about, he is a wealth of knowledge on his website about the topic. He covers at least three major different styles of vacuum systems. I'm going to touch on them here. And also he's got just lots and lots of supplies for doing veneer work. But anyway, what I'm going to cover first is the various vacuum systems that you can build in your shop. I've got two examples up here that I've built. The smaller one here was the first one that I did. This is kind of the poster child for Joe Woodworker type vacuum systems. And then Ricky Alexander approached me. He wanted one for doing larger projects, you know, like 4x8 foot type projects. I came up with that one. We'll go over that in more detail in a little bit. One of the things that I learned early on is you can develop a lot of pressure with one of these things. It's deceiving. You can get 1,700 pounds per square foot, which is roughly like, you know, parking one axle of your truck, you know, on top of whatever this object is you're trying to stick down. A vacuum system like this is ideal to hook to a vacuum bag. The vacuum bag would, is a natural container. It's gonna draw down evenly on your veneering project. It will handle irregularly shaped objects. One of the things that I've seen it used very often for is some of the Asian-inspired pieces of furniture that have a bow front to them. You know, try putting clamps on that. So the vacuum systems work very well for that. Large flat objects, a lot of times will make a tabletop, especially for a tool. I will laminate two pieces of 3/4-inch plywood together to make like the router tables that I've made you know, one of which is over at Rob's, and the club has one here. They're formed by making 2 3/4-inch sheets of plywood with tight bond glue, and then clamped together for a day with one of these vacuum bags, and then you just shape the edges and the corners. I usually round the corner so you don't kill yourself when you bump into that corner, which is just the right height to hit your hip as you go by. A lot of people use these types of systems for vacuum chucking on a lathe. I know Dan's got one. I'm not sure if any of the other turners have availed themselves of such a thing, but it's a nifty way to take a hunk of wood and just hold it up to your spindle, turn the vacuum on, and it sucks the item, you know, down, and as long as the vacuum is maintained, it provides a stable surface for turning. Okay, the two websites that I referred to a moment ago is joewoodworker.com and veneersupplies.com. At the Joe Woodworker site, he will explain to you how to build examples of these vacuum pumps that I've got here. These are called a cycling and electric pump, EVS, I think he refers to it as. Electric vacuum system, I believe is what it stands for. Some of the individual parts and pieces, if you want to do a hybrid of this, the parts and pieces you can get at veneersupplies.com. And also, most anything in the way of veneer, items to cut the veneer with, glue, you know, vacuum bags, all that type of stuff is at Veneer Supplies. The three primary types of vacuum systems like this are the Venturi system, which is a device you can hook up to your compressor that as air escapes your compressor, it will generate a vacuum. A continuous run, which would be just taking one of these pumps and, you know, stab a hose onto the barb fitting on there and hook it up to a bag, and it'll draw a vacuum as long as the pump's running. So if you got it in such a place as that you don't mind hearing the pump noise, that'll work fine. Then there's the cycling electric type, which is what these are. Okay, the Venturi system that I referred to a moment ago, it starts off with the airflow that comes out of the compressor going through here, going through a restriction in the center of that Venturi. The exhaust goes straight out there, but what happens is, in the meantime, you've got a small hole there that the air goes past that creates a vacuum. So you hook that up to whatever you want a source of vacuum pipe to. A lot of people are perfectly happy to use this on a compressor and hook it up to their lathe, and that becomes their vacuum chuck. And lower half of that drawing there is a picture of what one of those would look like. Okay, the Venturi system requires a compressor. It's cheaper and lighter than electric. You know, it's quite portable except for the compressor part. The whole kit for doing the thing is $258. Probably the fastest of the type, but the disadvantage is it's tethered to a compressor. Next one up there is a continuous run type. There's two examples there of what a continuous run form factor would look like. The first one's a 1 CFM pump. The one on the right is a 5 CFM pump. You would hook a hose to it, you know, like what is on one of these here. And that's just a method of transferring the vacuum over to a bag, assuming that you're going to use a bag with this. And it shows a vacuum gauge and a port there for switching the vacuum. Some of the features of the continuous run, it is very portable, you know, similar to this one that I have here, except it cycles. As far as cost of the unit, the 1 CFM you can get by with as little as under $300. The 5.5 CFM would be under $400. But the disadvantage is the unit would have to run for as long as you require vacuum. So if you were going to do a 7 or 8 hour glue up, or something like that, your unit would have to run for that length of time. And okay, then the next one is the cycling electric. This is a picture that I lifted off of Joe Woodworker's website. I kind of used that as a model for what I built. There were a couple of things that I didn't like about it. The wires looked a little vulnerable there, and there was a starter capacitor down in the lower portion of this thing that had exposed screws on it that I decided that based on where I suspected I was going to be carrying this thing, I thought that to be a little risky. So I chose to do it a different way. Okay, some of the features of the cycling electric, it is very portable. As you can see by my unit there, it's standalone. And that whole thing, except for the PVC, comes pretty much as a kit. You can buy the pump from Joe Woodworker. I cover in a little bit what the costs of that are. All that brass comes from him. I priced it out when I built the unit for Jane and found out that I could get those components from Joe Woodworker cheaper than I could source it locally. So I chose to do that. This is the brass kit, or this is the kit that you get from him, the various parts that are in there for about $170. And probably, you know, six of those items on there I couldn't even find locally. Couldn't even find them on other sources of the internet. So since he makes that his business to put these kits together, I chose to go with that. The heart of the unit is the pump. This is a gassed pump, 5.5 CFM. The first one of those that I built was this one here. It turned out to be a little noisy, but I lived with it. And then when Ricky wanted me to build one, Gast improved their pump considerably. They even dropped the price of the thing a little bit. When I turned that thing on the first time, I was listening to the amount of noise that that thing made, and I thought, I think I need to replace this pump. It is pretty quiet. Okay, as far as the pneumatic schematic as to how you do one of these cycling electric pumps, this is how you would hook the thing up. On successive slides here, I will segment the thing to show you how this thing works. I mean, it looks a little intimidating at first, but regardless of what form factor this thing takes, I mean, this small one in front of you here compared to the big one is identically the same components that are on this slide. They're just hooked up slightly different way. You know, got different size components like the vacuum tanks and the way they're organized. You know, you're only limited by your imagination. Okay, the airflow on one of these units, if you follow that red line in the center, the air that is extracted out of the bag goes through that vacuum switching valve. The vacuum switching valve would be like these red-handled objects here and down here. So as soon as you engage the hose there, hook that up to the vacuum reservoirs, it starts extracting air from the bag, goes through a check valve, and then through the pump and out through the exhaust of the pump. The initial vacuum on the unit occurs by way of these vacuum reservoirs. The vacuum reservoirs are these large tanks here and these really large tanks over here. What Ricky was going to do was fairly large projects, you know, like 4x4, 4x8 items. So I thought that extracting that much air quickly out of a bag was going to require some pretty good amount of reservoir. So this is to empty the excess air out of that bag in a hurry. And then the pump takes over and recovers that vacuum. Well, you're kind of in a race against time with your setup time on your glue. Because when you put down a very thin amount of glue, it's going to want to start setting up pretty quickly. So in a lot of cases, you got maybe 10 or 15 minutes to work with. It can take on a small pump. As a matter of fact, the pump that Ricky originally gave me to try to do this was a 1 CFM. And to empty that bag took about 18 minutes. As you start drawing pressure on this thing, the tendency is going to want to be when the excess glue, your squeeze out, starts occurring, the piece of veneer is going to want to move on the substrate. So that's part of why you have to wrap tape around this thing to try to keep it from moving, and you want to try to get it down in a hurry. Try to keep it to 10 minutes maximum on evacuation time.
No, what it does, you run it empty without attaching it to the bag, and so you make a vacuum in the tubes, and then you hook it up to the bag.
The idea is to get the excess air out of that bag as quickly as you can. The pump then takes the air out of here, so it runs for a couple of minutes to evacuate the air out of here. And then once you reach the cutoff vacuum level, which I've got these things adjusted to where they're about 22 inches of mercury, they'll shut off. So then as leakage occurs, it will cycle on its own. All of that depends on a vacuum switch. The vacuum switch is here on this pump, and it's inside that electrical box down there on this other pump. I chose to put it inside that box down there to protect it, because since all the works was down on the bottom here and I knew the way Ricky was going to handle this thing, I kind of figured it needed a little protection. Okay, that's the initial vacuum part. What the thing to note here is on the vacuum reservoirs, that is the thing that gets the air out in a hurry. This next page there shows recovery on that. And this is where the system part of this device occurs. You've got a head reservoir there. As a matter of fact, all of these things work together. This MAC valve here is the thing that switches the compressor on and off. I take that back. It's a combination of the MAC valve and the vacuum switch. The MAC valve is electrical. You can just barely see the wire squeaking out of the corner there. The vacuum switch is also an electrical device that hooks up to the MAC valve and the pump. The check valve just keeps the air going one direction. So it is the thing that once this thing shuts off, you can't draw air back this way and therefore put air back in the bag. So this whole system here is intended to remove the head pressure from the pump once it's decided that the vacuum chambers are up to whatever limit you specified. Now, the cost of a system like this, the kit of brass that I showed you a picture of there, about $170. The pump is $310. These are prices as of about a week ago. The total of the thing is around $480. And then on top of that, you would add, you know, some PVC and, you know, a little bit of wire and whatever other accessories that...
You got to buy the hose too?
The hose is part of the kit. Okay, then the next thing is the vacuum bags. You've got a whole assortment of bags available, all the way from this 2x2 unit that's up here. I've had this thing for probably 10 years. I've tried to kill it and can't, so they're pretty durable. The Joe Woodworker has a new type of plastic that they located for their bags. That's what I got for this unit for Ricky. It's a 20 mil, I believe it is. I was a little skeptical about it, about the pliability of it. It just seemed a little fragile, but so far in using the thing, it doesn't seem to have been. The 2x2 unit, like I show over here, with the air fitting and the closure, is about $50. I've also got a 4x4 in a similar arrangement that's about 120. You could do a do-it-yourself vinyl. They'll send you the vinyl and enough to make a 54x72 bag. And that's 180. They've got three sides that are closed, and then you've got that PVC closure. You know, like that big long thing there that'll close up the bag. Another item that I heartily recommend is this, what is called a breather mesh. Depending on your circumstances, on whatever it is you're gluing up, you may need some of this. The main reason that you would need such a thing is when you put a glue-up item in there, and a glue-up would consist of a platen. You put wax paper on the platen to keep any glue from sticking to the platen. You then put your substrate that you're going to put your veneer on. You put another platen on top, again treated the same way with wax paper. You put that in your vacuum bag. This is after you've got glue applied. And typically what I'll do is I'll tape the corners, you know, run a blue tape around the corners there to keep the whole thing from sliding this way like a deck of cards. Put it in the center of your vacuum bag. And if you locate this thing underneath the vacuum port on the bag, it is going to tend to want to stick down to your substrate and shut off the source of vacuum. So if you put some of this breather mesh inside there, it'll do two things. It'll allow that vacuum to flow freely, and it'll also reduce the potential for these platens on here to puncture the bag. So that's kind of the statement about the breather mesh. Once you get this thing and figure out how to locate all the pieces and parts, so that you wind up with a neat looking installation, you wind up with a finished product. What I chose to do on the first round was put spools out there just by putting a dowel and then cutting some pieces of plywood on the scroll saw and doing a little finishing on those. Screw the thing onto the frame so that he had a place to wind up the cords. What I did after that is I went and modified the tree here for the vacuum switching, so I could add a second hose to be able to operate two bags at one time independently of each other. I'll explain why you would want to do that in a little bit here. Okay, as far as the various forms of packaging that you would want to consider doing on here, by the way, Joe Woodworker has a whole gallery. He encourages people that build systems like this to take pictures of it when they're done and send it in. So if you look at those gallery pictures, you really see some bizarre shots.
Bob, what's the purpose of the head reservoir, whatever you call it, the little one?
The little reservoir there is a place for the pump to start drawing air from when it first starts up. So that is going to be atmospheric pressure. So what you want to do is you want to make sure that the vacuum pump, in order to make it last as long as possible, you want to make sure that thing sees atmospheric pressure for the first few seconds that it starts up. That reservoir is that atmospheric pressure. Then once it finally achieves, it comes up to speed and starts drawing a vacuum, then it will overcome the check valve, and then it will start drawing air out of the reservoirs. Okay, here's another one where the owner of this one chose to put some pearl paint on there. Kind of got carried away with the paint job. And this is one where the guy had an apartment, and he was trying to operate one of these units in there. So you can see his the greenish part there. He had this thing actually installed in his dining room. So the vacuum reservoirs are the greenish part there, and then the column tops on there was the pump, hid the pump mechanism. So people would come over to his place and, you know, they'd see this thing and they thought it was a piece of art. They didn't realize it was a tool. Okay, here's a couple other form factors. This particular one, some guy used one of those little hot dog storage tanks from down there at Harbor Freight. I think you can pick those things up for around $20. makes a good reservoir. I have even seen people use old dive tanks for similar vacuum reservoirs. So that's kind of all I have on the pump portion. And then I had a couple of other topics that I wanted to cover here, such as how you use one of these things and why you would use it. Some of what I've used it for. I discussed before about how you would glue something up, glue up a piece of artwork or something like that onto a substrate. What I've done in the past generally, what I do when I put veneer on an object, I will put veneer on both sides. When you're gluing veneer on something and that thing dries, the glue dries, it develops a huge amount of force. I noticed this one time I noticed it in particular with a project of Ricky's. He built a crib for his kid, or for his granddaughter. Put veneer on one side of the crib face, and it has a huge cup in it now because he didn't put veneer on the other side because he didn't know any better. So generally what I will do when I start a project like that is I'll put veneer usually on the edges first, and unfortunately you can't use a pump system like this for doing that. It's a matter of clamping it, taping it, and doing all that to get the edge on. But the large surface here, you put glue on that. You would put glue on the substrate and not on the veneer, because as soon as the veneer sees moisture, it is going to start reacting to the moisture. I usually do, yes. What glue you use on veneer is kind of a religious topic. You know, various people feel very strongly about which glue you ought to use. I've tried several and have settled on just regular tight bond 2 or tight bond 1. Sometimes even depending on what I'm putting on there, I will sometimes even go back to just regular Elmer's white glue, primarily because when that stuff bleeds through, as sometimes it will, it'll dry clear. So it won't impart any color. Then you put the other platen on top of there. You know, I tape the unit together, put it in the bag, clamp it, hook the hose up to it, and draw a vacuum. And then let it sit there, usually overnight. When you get that glue in as tight of a confine as what you're going to have here, and you get it in a vacuum bag that is additionally confining, it takes a tremendous amount of time for that stuff to dry. So that's why I recommend 8 hours at least. And then once you take the thing out, again, you want to leave it out there in atmosphere and let it acclimate for another 8 hours before you you know, start trying to work it by sanding it or put a finish on it or something like that. You need to get the rest of the moisture out of it. When you get ready to, you put your marquetry piece on the other side. I like to use for artwork purposes, I'll use MDF. For structural stuff, I like to use Baltic birch because it's got additional plies, but at any rate, you want to use a stable wood. You probably don't want to use dimensional lumber. I much prefer plywood on a piece of furniture, you know, if you're going to put the veneer and marquetry on it. And then you wind up applying your marquetry panel to the object, you glue it up the same way.
What's the thickness of your veneer?
42nd of an inch.
The same
sheet you used last week? Yes. Mm-hmm. Okay, I brought along some examples of some of that veneer, like what she talked about there. Another thing you frequently have to do when you go get veneer you'll wind up with some pieces like this. I don't know if I can get it where the camera can catch it, but this stuff is far from flat. If you go trying to glue this up as is, you're probably not going to have a lot of success. It's going to bubble, it's going to do all kinds of bad things. But we have a vacuum press. We can handle stuff like that. What I do for those situations, I will take some of these platens like these that are laced with 1/8 inch deep holes so that vacuum will distribute evenly over the surface. I do this just on one side, and in this particular case here, I've got two platens inside there. And one of them is inverted, so that I've got two absolutely flat surfaces. When I get ready to flatten something, what I'll do is mist it with this veneer softener. And you can see it already reacting to the moisture. But what this veneer softener is water, glycerin, and a little bit of glue. That's the recipe that Joe Woodworker will tell you about. And so if you're really adventuresome, you can go down to the drugstore and find various components down there to make that, or you can get it from Joe Woodworker. Now then, what you do is you put that piece inside there. Normally what you would want to do is print or put some unprinted newspaper, in other words, newspaper stock, which is getting increasingly hard to get a hold of these days. Yes. Yeah, I had to run them across the table saw quite a few times. This is the quiet one. What I'm doing is I'm watching the gauge on the side there. If Buzz can zoom in on that.
There's a very point you don't want to go over.
it's just harder to get there.
Yeah.
Yep.
Just to flatten it out, though, how long would you want to leave that on there?
To flatten a piece of veneer like this, I would probably wind up leaving that for 3 to 4 days.
Oh, really?
Yeah. It's going to take quite a while for the piece of veneer to get moisture all the way to the core. And then the idea is, once it's done that, then suck the moisture back out again while it's exposed to an absolute flat surface. And then when you first take it out, it will be flat. When you expose it to Georgia humidity, though, for another week or two, it'll start wrinkling back up again. It'll be as wrinkled as what you saw when I took it out.
Now, how often will this start kicking out again? How long will it take?
Depends on how tight it seeps out of there.
Depends on how tight I've got all the joints. The biggest culprit is that seal bar across there. And what I've noticed over time is with this bag here, you get dust, debris, bits of glue, bits of wood, all that kind of thing on this inside edge here. It doesn't want to seal exactly right, so that'll cause it to cycle about every 15 minutes. I primarily buy my veneer from one of two sources. One is B&B Rare Woods out in Golden, Colorado. He is absolutely fanatic about quality of veneer. He does everything in his power to treat it properly. I mean, he stores it flat, he keeps dust off of it. His care and so forth in shipping is just out of this world. And another one that does pretty much the same thing is Certainly Woods in, it's either Pennsylvania or New York. I forget which it is. Now, some people would argue that because of the additives in the water, such as the glycerin and some of the other byproducts, I forget exactly what else is in there, some people will argue that'll affect your finish. So you just, you know, if you flattened it 3 or 4 times, you may have to be prepared for that. I'm not usually bothered by that kind of stuff, because usually what I'll do is I'll put shellac on there first. And I was kind of instructed that shellac will adhere to anything, and anything will adhere to shellac. So I'm kind of that school. And so far it hasn't let me down.
Bob, I think you said that had glue in it. Does that have a tendency to help it stay flat? The spray bottle, you said?
It's a sizing of sort.
Kind of
a additional lubricant to make the
fibers.
Make the water slicker. Mm. To show you some of what I use a system like this for, this was one of the initial panels that I did for my daughter's headboard, and you can see from here, this is the Baltic birch that I made the panel out of. And then when you get ready to apply the marquetry to the panel, you put glue on the substrate itself, which in this case would be the plywood. Then you apply the marquetry to that, put a platen top and bottom, tape it, and put it in the bag as quickly as you can. The reason for this one being extra is that I got kind of frisky here on this last panel and decided, well, Paul Search was busy trying to convince me to use a belt sander to get rid of the excess veneer tape off of the face. And this coloration right there is what's known as a sand through. When this veneer is only a 42nd of an inch thick, if you dwell on one spot a little bit too long, you wind up achieving a sand through. I tried to fix it with coloring and various other stuff and finally gave up. Yes, sir?
Is there any particular reason why you didn't have to tape the edges?
I didn't do anything with the edges on this because it was going to be inset in a headboard, so there was going to be a dado that it was going to be sliding down into. if you aren't going to see it, there's no sense in
because it doesn't affect
putting it on the edge.
How thick is the substrate going to be?
I'd recommend at least a half inch.
At least half an inch?
Yeah. Anything over that is just structural at that point. You're going to run the risk, you know, anything less than that, the veneer, you saw this stuff starting to wrinkle up when water touched it. That's going to wind up working to your detriment if you put veneer on one side and not the other. There's going to be, you know, tremendous amount of pressure when that glue starts setting up to try to warp that thing.
Thickness.
Yeah, ideally, you at least want to put the same thickness of veneer on the other side. Ideally, put the same species of veneer on the other side, but at least put veneer on the other side.
Do you have to do it at the same time as you put your marker on top?
Within a day or two. The longer you leave it exposed, the more risk that you run of the thing starting to warp. Yeah, that goes back to the reason I said I like to use the Baltic birch. Because of the number of plies that are involved there, there's Baltic birch plywood will tend to be better quality. There's also usually fewer voids, if any. And also because of the number of plies, it will be less likely to bend. As Buzz zooms the camera in there, he's zooming in on a void after I talked about it. Yeah.
Because of the wood problem.
Well, when you need it to be structural, I don't usually like to use MDF in a structural environment.
Yeah.
You know, the moisture will affect it. It will also, on its own, it will warp. You know, if you expose it to moisture. As far as substrates that I like to use is anymore. I get most of my plywood from down at Swanee Lumber. Yeah, that was one of the things that Paul treated us to was the fact that he was part of the product development team for Gorilla Glue. He was one of the ones doing testing on the stuff, and he explained to us how to use Gorilla Glue. I think most of us wind up using a whole lot too much. So Rob can plug his ears on that. Rob thinks more glue is better.
I just
won't
use it.
But anyway, what he does is he puts it on with a roller squeegee, it being that thin. And then just before he applies the veneer to the substrate, he will use a sprayer like that to spray the glue surface to activate the glue. That is what actually is the catalyst to activate the glue. You put the veneer on immediately and put it in the bag. And about a 15 to 30 minute setup in a bag, and that stuff is down hard. You can take it out, and because of the very low amount of water that's involved in that whole thing, you're ready to start working it right then. You put the glue on there first because you want the glue ready to receive the marquetry panel, and then the last thing that you want to do is introduce water to it, because water is what's going to activate the Gorilla Glue. And this will even work at a project, around your shop or out in the yard or something like that. Just before you're ready to seat two pieces involving Gorilla Glue together, if you spritz it with a little bit of water, that'll cause it to activate. If you put too much more on there, what's going to wind up happening is it's going to foam. And in the case of veneer, I did that once. And all your joints here, where you've cut the veneer, underneath the pressure of that bag, that glue is going to come up through that joint and start going out to the sides, because that's the only place it's got to go. So you take the thing out of the bag and you got all these black clouds around every one of your joints. The one thing I will tell you is on these vacuum reservoirs, they make a foam type PVC that is commonly used in sanitary drains in construction, home building, and that type of thing. It works well there because there's no pressure involved. Because all you're doing is transporting waste and wastewater. When you're putting 26 inches worth of mercury, exposing this stuff to it, that foam type PVC will collapse. It may not hurt you, but it's going to wreck your project.
Well, this thing has not come back on yet. Is this?
The reservoirs here contain that many cubic feet. I mean, if you knew how to calculate the cubic feet here, that's a reservoir that is maintaining that much vacuum on that bag. Now, if you've got a leak of some type, what's going to wind up happening is it's going to cycle on until it draws it back down to 26 inches of mercury again, and then it'll shut off. This particular switch, I think, has a 4-inch range. But it's got an upper limit that is the main thing. I want it to cut off at 22 or 23. And then when it comes down to around 19 or 20, it'll switch back on again. If you introduce a leak to it, you know, I kind of forced the leak there by opening the hose that wasn't connected to anything. So it got down to around the 18-inch range. And it will now run again until it gets back to around 22, 23. So I could run two separate bags.
Independent?
Yes, completely independent. The reason I started doing that is when you're flattening a piece of veneer, that has to remain under vacuum for about 4 days. And if you've got something that you want to glue up, you need another port or another hose and another bag. Fortunately, between Ricky's bags and mine, I've got about 5 of them. Any questions? All right, thank you.